last prime minister, her 15th. And as she was speaking, we just got a statement from the king, which is a phrase people will have to get used to hearing and saying. And if I may, I'd like to read the statement. I don't know if we have it to bring it up for you on the screen, but while we are checking that out, this is a statement from Buckingham Palace. It's a statement from the king, and it reads, "The death of my beloved mother, Her Majesty the Queen, is a moment of the greatest sadness for me and all members of my family. We mourn profoundly the passing of a cherished sovereign and a much loved mother. I know her loss will be deeply felt throughout the country, the realms, and the Commonwealth, and by countless people around the world. During this period of mourning and change, my family and I will be comforted and sustained by our knowledge of the respect and deep affection in which the Queen was so widely held." And with that, let me just see. Are we now going to go? You know, why don't we take this moment while we're talking about the Queen's death? Why don't we talk about her life? And in order to do that, the CBC's Margaret Evans has spent some time looking back at the life and the legacy and the experiences of this long reigning monarch. Let's have a look at Margaret's item.
A golden thread running through generations. That's how one of Queen Elizabeth II's many prime ministers described her reign, the longest in British history. By the time of her death, she was, without doubt, one of the most recognizable figures on the world stage, and one of the most private, an enduring contradiction. Elizabeth Alexandra Mary was born on April 21st, 1926, a princess third in line to the throne, but not expected to accede to it. Her childhood was spent in the company of the corgis that would become the habit of a lifetime, and in the bosom of a tight family unit, us four, they called themselves. Her parents, the Duke and Duchess of York, her younger sister Margaret, and Lilibet, as Elizabeth was known.
I think one reason for Elizabeth's great resilience was she had, for a member of the royal family, a relatively normal and crucially very happy childhood.
Elizabeth's destiny changed along with that of her father, who became King George VI, when his brother, Edward VIII, chose love over duty, abdicating the throne in 1936 to marry an American divorcee. Just 3 years later, George would become a wartime king when the United Kingdom declared war on Nazi Germany. The king and queen stayed in London during the Blitz, a decision that earned them respect amongst ordinary people, especially after Buckingham Palace itself was hit. Their daughters were mainly at Windsor, but they too were in the public eye, Elizabeth joining the Auxiliary Territorial Service when she turned 18, the start of a lifelong connection to the armed forces. It was also during those years that Elizabeth set her cap at a young naval cadet named Philip, a member of the Greek royal family who also happened to be her third cousin.
This was a marriage for love, but perhaps one for suitability, for the dynasty as well. Princess Elizabeth, as then she was, fell in love, there's no doubt about it, with a young man who looked like a Viking god. But she was dutiful enough to fall in love only within a selected gene pool.
They were married in 1947, breaking up the old quartet of us four. Their own children soon to follow, first Prince Charles, then Princess Anne. Elizabeth began taking on more of her father's duties when his health began to fail. And it was while she and Philip were on a royal tour in Kenya in 1952 that news reached the couple of King George's death. She returned home to the United Kingdom, a queen and head of the Commonwealth, at the age of just 25.
Elizabeth is led here in solemn procession to be anointed Elizabeth II.
Elizabeth's sense of duty, say royal historians, was already deeply ingrained, attributed to her father's tutelage and in part to the scandal of her uncle's abdication.
It was a great shock to all of them. And I think she was therefore determined that, you know, nothing like that was going to happen during her reign.
Two more children, Andrew and Edward, would follow. The Queen would send a message to the moon with Neil Armstrong.
The salad is ready.
And television cameras were allowed in for a glimpse of the royal family for the first time.
Can I fit on them?
There was also much travel. The Queen placing great importance on her role as head of the Commonwealth, a body, she insisted, bore no resemblance to empires of the past.
As Queen of Canada, I am proud of this country.
Canada was a frequent destination, although not always a welcoming one.
A few boos and hisses, and this police reaction.
She made more than 20 trips to Canada, the most significant in 1982. She and then Prime Minister Pierre Elliott Trudeau signed the act that effectively brought the Canadian Constitution home. The Queen and Trudeau seemed to enjoy an almost mischievous relationship, and there was that famous photo.
And Trudeau was a great character at a time when there was questions about the monarchy in the 60s and 70s and its status, not least in Quebec. I think Trudeau eased her progress through that, and I think they actually probably ended up, you know, quite friendly.
Your whole life.
But I think that then laps over to the son, Justin.
Thank you, Mr. Prime Minister of Canada, for making me feel so old.
The golden thread, though, wasn't always in evidence. Indeed, there were times when the monarchy seemed positively tarnished. In the early 1990s, the British public was unhappy over its price tag, the Queen offering to pay taxes on her personal income in 1992. And three of her children divorced, none more spectacularly so than the Prince and Princess of Wales, Charles and Diana.
Well, there were three of us in this marriage, so it was a bit crowded.
In an explosive interview in 1995, Diana revealed details of their relationship, including extramarital affairs. But she remained immensely popular, wanting, she said, to be remembered as the Queen of people's hearts. And for many, she was. When she was killed in a Paris car crash in 1997, the Queen's critics accused her of misjudging the nation's deep affection for Diana. There was reportedly an initial reluctance to lower the flag at Buckingham Palace, and many said the Queen was too slow to return from Balmoral, where she'd remained with Diana's children.
That definitely shook the institution, there's no doubt about that. I was there the day that the Queen returned to the palace, and people were worried, you know, what would the crowds be like?
And it did prompt a shift from the Queen, who made a live and very personal address to the nation.
So what I say to you now, as your queen and as a grandmother, I say from my heart. First, I want to pay tribute to Diana myself. She was an exceptional and gifted human being.
More sadness would follow for the Queen in 2002, the year of her golden jubilee. She lost both her mother and sister within months of each other. Prince Philip left to fill the void.
After that, there was really no one left who could speak to her on terms of equality, except him. No one who could call her Lilibet.
Another constant, though, her seemingly endless stamina for public duties also remained. The Queen was a powerful tool in Britain's diplomatic arsenal. She could and would meet countless world leaders and diplomats without letting slip even a hint of what she might have thought of them. It was soft power that could make a difference. In 2011, she made a symbolic visit to the Republic of Ireland. A year later, in Northern Ireland, she met and shook hands with Martin McGuinness, the Deputy First Minister and a former IRA commander. With the marriage of the Queen's grandson, Prince William, to Kate Middleton in 2011, the image of a more stable royal family emerged. By the time she reached her 90th birthday in 2016, she was more popular than ever in the United Kingdom. Still regularly attending to the transatlantic relationship with the United States. And not above offering a little assistance if royal protocols got stuck.
The Queen's standard is lowered.
But in a blow to the Queen in 2021, Barbados removed her as head of state, citing a desire to break free from its colonial past. And a follow-up tour by the Duke and Duchess of Cambridge to other Caribbean nations was criticized as being tone-deaf and not going far enough in acknowledging Britain's role or that of the monarchy in the slave trade. The trials of family would also return to haunt Elizabeth, a favored son, Prince Andrew, suspended from royal duties in the wake of sexual abuse allegations in 2019. And in 2020, her grandson, Prince Harry, and his wife, Meghan, the Duchess of Sussex, walked away from their royal roles in a family split that included unspecified allegations of racism within the royal family.
I don't think you go on and on and on, as Elizabeth did, by worrying about the headlines. I think she was always absolutely focused on her duty and her service.
And duty would soon call again, this time in the form of the global pandemic. More than 150,000 people lost their lives to COVID-19 in the United Kingdom. The Queen evoking Britain's wartime spirit and speaking of a world united in common endeavor.
We should take comfort that while we may have more still to endure, better days will return. We will be with our friends again. We will be with our families again. We will meet again.
The Queen spent much of Britain's lockdown at Windsor Castle with Prince Philip. But in the spring of 2021, after 73 years of marriage, she lost the husband she described as her strength and stay. He was 99, his death a reminder to the nation of the Queen's own mortality, people mourning both for her and with her. She emerged from mourning, a little smaller, a little more fragile looking. But the golden thread was still there, and wending its way inexorably towards the next milestone. This one, platinum. Elizabeth marked her 70th year on the throne February 6th, 2022. And in June of that year, the nation came together to celebrate her platinum jubilee. The famous Mall was again draped in Union Jacks and plump with well-wishers. Shops full of anything and everything relating to the Queen, corgis included.
Good evening, Swan.
Good evening, Your Majesty.
They'd made an appearance in a video for the Diamond Jubilee a decade earlier, along with the James Bond of the day and featuring the Queen herself.
I do hope you're having a lovely jubilee.
This time, it was Paddington Bear's turn, offering up an answer to one of the great questions of the Queen's reign, just what she'd been keeping in her purse all those years.
You would like a marmalade sandwich? I always keep one for emergencies.
So do I. I keep mine in here. For later.
But the Platinum Jubilee was also notable for what the Queen did not do, absenting herself from some of the key events, other members of the royal family stepping in. Earlier in the year, Prince Charles read the speech from the throne for his mother for the first time. It was a nod to the inevitable changing of the guard to come, however unthinkable for some.
We all in some way knew her. This huge figure, this sort of massive oak tree that was on the horizon, is suddenly felled. So I think actually we're all bereft.
The sheer longevity of Elizabeth II's reign is partly what embedded her so deeply in the fabric of the nation. With her passing, Britain's test going forward will be to maintain its sense of